Hello students, welcome back to our third slide of this chapter, that is absorption by roots, the processes involved. Now as we were clear about the process of osmosis in the last slide, we had even demonstrated and understood about the experiment of osmosis. In today's slide, we have to learn and understand about the modified version of the experiment which we had done in the last slide. Now for that, to understand the modified version, we need to just quickly revise to what we had done in the last slide. Last slide, we had understood about the experiment of osmosis and how we had taken a beaker which was being filled with water. We had taken thistle funnel. Inside the thistle funnel, we had taken sugar solution. That was concentrated sugar solution. The thistle funnel was being covered with the cellophane membrane, and that cellophane membrane acted like your semi-permeable membrane. Okay, after few hours or after 1 hour, it was being seen that the level of the sugar in the thistle funnel raised. I would just want you all to see this diagram from your textbook, or you all can just go back to the slide and just see the slide also. Now, why did the level rise? The level rose because of the osmosis. Okay, the level rose because of osmosis. Why? That is because the definition of osmosis says that movement of the water molecule from the high water concentration to the low water concentration. That is from the beaker into the sugar solution. What exactly does this modified version of the experiment number 2 want to say? In the modified version, inside the beaker, water fees take little less concentrated sugar solution, okay, as compared to the sugar solution which is more concentrated in the thistle funnel. We have to see what would be the result. The result would be exactly the same what we saw in experiment number 2. Now let us label this experiment as experiment number 3. Okay, why? Because this is a new experiment that which we are performing. The entire setup would be the same. Just that now what you are doing is, inside the beaker, instead of taking plain water, just add little less concentrated sugar solution, and you have to observe the result after 1 hour. Now what do you see? You see that the levels in the thistle funnel, okay, I would just want you to just see this diagram again. The levels in the thistle funnel have risen again. Now why the levels have risen again? It's the same concept. That is because the water has moved from the beaker into the thistle funnel through your same cellophane paper or cellophane membrane. I would like to mention it again, the entire setup or the setup of the experiment is the same, right? So this again proves that the osmosis has taken place. Now, one more condition has been put across. What if we make use of a rubber sheet or muslin cloth instead of the cellophane paper or the membrane as a barrier on the mouth of the thistle funnel? Okay, and at the mouth of the thistle funnel, what if we make use of these two as the barriers? Now talking about the first case, that is rubber sheet. Rubber is a complete impermeable membrane. Here you need to understand the difference between impermeable, semi-permeable, freely permeable and selectively semi-permeable membrane. Students, I mentioned 4 important terms. I said you need to understand 4 terms. Impermeable. Impermeable means what? It will not allow any solute or solvent to pass through. That is called as impermeable. Freely permeable, it will allow all the things to pass through. That means all the solute, all the solvent are going to pass through. Semi-permeable, semi is half. it is going to only allow the solvent to pass through. But when I say selectively semi-permeable, it is going to allow solvent to pass through along with certain solutes to pass through. Okay, I hope all the four definitions are clear. Now, if I talk about rubber sheet, your rubber sheet is going to behave as a complete impermeable membrane. Now, if it is impermeable membrane, and if you set up the entire apparatus as shown in the previous diagram, it is obvious neither the water is going to enter into the thistle funnel, nor the sugar from the thistle funnel is going to enter into the water, right? So there is going to be no change in the experiment. The experiment is going to be as it was. The setup is going to show no change. What if you are going to make use of the muslin cloth in the experiment? Now, muslin cloth, I hope everyone knows what is a muslin cloth. The cloth is having very large pores in it. And because of the large pore size, what happens is, since the thistle funnel is kept inverted on the beaker, what happens is the sugar solution, the sugar molecules, they freely diffuse into the water. Why? Because of gravity. Sugar molecules, I repeat, the sugar molecules from the thistle funnel, they start diffusing into the beaker, making the beaker into a sugar solution, converting the beaker solution instead of water into a sugar solution. Okay, so what is happening is, here the muslin cloth is behaving as a freely permeable membrane. Freely permeable as in what? It's not only allowing the sugar to pass through the muslin cloth, but it is also allowing the water to pass through the muslin cloth. Matlab aapka solute bhi ja raha hai, aapka solvent bhi ja raha hai. Why? Because the muslin cloth has large size pores in it. Okay, and since the thistle funnel is kept inverted on the beaker, because of the gravity, force of the gravity, the sugar solution entirely gets mixed with your beaker solution. Okay, so this is the two cases which are being mentioned in your modified version of experiment of osmosis. Now, the third case, what if we make use of the Viskin bag? Now, what exactly is a Viskin bag? It is nothing but a bag which is made up of the cellulose material. Okay, you can just Google about this Viskin bag if you all don't know what material I'm talking about, so that you can be aware of what material is this, right? So this is a material which acts as a semi-permeable membrane. Students, semi-permeable membrane as in it is going to allow the passage of only solvent molecules to pass through. Your solvent as in I'm talking about only water molecules to pass through. Okay, so let us understand the experimental setup. Now, in this experimental setup, what have I taken? Now, this one is your Viskin bag, and this Viskin bag is being tied a knot at one end. Okay, it's a bag which is being tied a knot at one end. Now, inside this Viskin bag, I have taken sugar solution. Okay, here you can see the labeling. This is the Viskin bag, okay, and inside the Viskin bag I have taken sugar solution. Okay, inside this Viskin bag you have to place a capillary tube. You have to place a capillary tube, and you have to place it in such a way that you can see the level of the sugar at a particular initial level. So for example, this is the initial level of the sugar, right? Now you have to tie a knot along with the capillary tube on this Viskin bag. Okay, tie a knot over here. This is the binding, a knot over here, okay, with a thread or something. And then the entire setup, okay, this along with the Viskin bag, along with the capillary tube, you have to place it in a beaker containing water. Okay, and this setup, you have to place it on a clamp. okay, you have to fix it on a stand, right? This is the entire setup of the experiment. Okay, clear? I hope the entire setup of the experiment is clear with you. Now, what exactly happens in the experiment? Now, when you keep the apparatus for an hour, you have to notice the process of osmosis even in this experiment, right? So, after an hour, what do you notice? You notice that the levels of the sugar in this capillary have risen up. So, if this was the initial level, now the levels have risen up to this level, okay? And this is being seen by the rising level in the capillary tube. Now, why is this happening? Okay, and again the same reason, that is because osmosis is happening. The concentration of the water in the beaker is higher as compared to the concentration of the water in the whisking bag, and therefore the water has been moving from the higher concentration to lower concentration, clearly indicating the process of osmosis. Now, apart from the process of osmosis, two important points what are clearly seen in all these above experiments, the last two experiments which I would want to say, is there are two liquids of the different concentrations which are involved in the experiment. Okay, now it is up to you that if you in what way do you want to consider the liquids? As in, do you want to consider it from the point of view of solute, or do you want to consider them from the point of solvent? So, if you are considering it from the point of water molecules, as in from the point of solvent molecules, then you would say that these liquids are present in two different regions of different concentrations of water molecules. Matlab, one region is in the beaker and other region is either in the thistle funnel, as you saw in experiment number 2, or it can be either in the whisking bag, as you saw in experiment number 3. Okay, and second is if you see these solutions, these liquids, from solute point of view, then how would you mention that these are present in two regions and their concentrations are also different, and here the two concentrations are from the point of view of solutes, and what is the solute that is used over here? The solute is sugar molecules, right? Why is it mentioned that they are seen in two regions? Because, my dear students, though in experiment number 2 we had taken water in the beaker, I agree, but the modified version clearly mentions that you have to take less concentrated sugar solutions. Matlab, aapke beaker mein bhi sugar hai, aapke thistle funnel mein bhi sugar solution hai. Okay? So, all what I mean to say is, when you consider your osmosis experiment, you have to keep in mind two important points. The first point is, two liquids involved hote hain. Theek hai? And ye dono liquids alag alag concentration mein paye jayenge. Right? Ek liquid hota hai aapke beaker mein, dusra liquid hota hai ya to thistle funnel mein ya to whisking bag mein. Okay? ये लिक्विड्स आप अपने मर्जी से डिफाइन कर सकते हो, या तो आप उनको सॉल्यूट के फॉर्म में डिफाइन करो या तो आप उनको सॉल्वेंट के फॉर्म में डिफाइन करो. दिस इज योर फर्स्ट पॉइंट. व्हाट इज द सेकंड पॉइंट ऑफ द एक्सपेरिमेंट? द सेकंड पॉइंट सेज दैट ऑलवेज इन एन ऑस्मोसिस एक्सपेरिमेंट देयर इज अ सेमी परमिएबल मेम्ब्रेन. नाउ इफ यू वुड सी एक्सपेरिमेंट नंबर 2, experiment number 3, and all the cases what we have considered, there is always a semi permeable membrane, either a cellophane sheet or a viscid band, right, which acts as a semi-permeable membrane. Now, what is the role of semi-permeable membrane? It is going to allow only the water molecules to pass through. We clearly saw in cases 1 and 2 that when rubber sheet or muslin cloth was being used in the experiments, they did not work. The experiment did not work, right? Why? Because they were either impermeable membrane or they were freely permeable membrane. So these are the two important points to be kept in your mind whenever we perform an osmosis experiment. Okay, I hope the concept of osmosis is very clear with you all, right? Now, the next important point about osmosis which you all need to understand: how long is going to osmosis continue? Okay, now if you go back to the experiment number 2, that is when you took a beaker and you kept the thistle funnel in it. Till when the water molecules are going to keep moving or keep passing through the cellophane membrane? Till when? How long? The answer is clear. Until and unless the water molecules have a balance with each other. As in, if there are 50 molecules on this side of the cellophane membrane and if there are 50 molecules on the other side of the membrane, till then the transfer is going to happen. So, until the concentration of the water molecule becomes equal or isotonic, in biological words, that's called as isotonic, on both the sides of the membrane, till then the transfer is going to continue. That means osmosis is going to continue. Okay, so my dear students, when I say that if I compare the concepts of the osmosis experiments, I would just see that in the experiment number 2, the levels of the sugar solution in the thistle funnel continues to rise. The weight also keeps on rising. So the height and the weight of the sugar solution is going to continuously rise until and unless the sugar the water molecules are same on both the sides of the membrane. But after a certain point of time, there is a reduction in the process of osmosis. Yes, this is what I write here, that after a particular increase in the weight and height of the rising column, there is a reduction in the process of osmosis. And why is there this reduction in the weight and why is there reduction in the process of osmosis? Why? Because a stage is reached when there is no osmosis which is going to happen. But this stage is going to reach even before the concentration of the water is going to be same on both the sides of the membrane. I hope you all are able to understand what I am trying to say. I am saying that osmosis is going to stop even before the isotonic stage has been reached. Now, why is that so? That is because in this stage of near to equilibrium, what happens is, ये आपका beaker है, उसके अंदर thistle funnel है, ठीक है? Maximum osmosis हो चुका है, maximum osmosis has happened. That means the water molecule have been moved into the thistle funnel. Now almost equilibrium is about to reach. But now there is no osmosis that is happening. Why? Because the water molecule from the beaker, they are forced to push, they tend to force upwards through the membrane. They are being forced to push upwards. Why? Because of the cellophane membrane. Why? Because of the process of osmosis. But at the same point of time, there is some weight pressure. What weight pressure? ऊपर समझो, आपके टिसल फनल में इतना ज्यादा पानी चला गया है, बट उसके पास शुगर सॉल्यूशन भी है, शुगर सॉल्यूट मॉलिक्यूल्स भी है. नीचे बीकर में सिर्फ पानी है, राइट? वॉटर इज गोइंग टू मूव अप. वाई? बिकॉज ऑफ दैट प्रोसेस ऑफ ऑस्मोसिस. इट हैज टू रीच द आइसोटोनिसिटी. That means it has to reach the equilibrium. But in the thistle funnel, the water molecules have been reached near to equilibrium. But this thistle funnel has enough of sugar molecules also. So it is having more weight. So because of that weight pressure from the above, what is happening? The water molecules are pushed downwards, and that pressure that is being exerted by the thistle funnel molecules is called as osmotic pressure. I hope you all understood what I'm trying to say. I'm saying that no doubt osmosis is not happening now. Why it is not happening? Even after the water molecules have not reached the equilibrium, right? But why is it not happening? Because of the weight pressure that is more in the thistle funnel. Because the thistle funnel is having water, the thistle funnel is having sugar, the beaker is having only water. So because of that weight pressure, the thistle funnel is not able to take more water. And it's not able to pull more water, इसलिए वो water molecules क्या हो रहा है, वो नीचे गिर जा रहे हैं. And that pressure is called as osmotic pressure. So let us quickly define what is osmotic pressure. It is nothing but minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent the passage of the solvent. Minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent. Prevent is to stop the passage of the pure solvent into the solution when the two solutions are being separated by the semi-permeable membrane. And this is what we notice in this statement, what I just said above. Okay? I hope this definition is clear. There's a small experiment to explain osmotic pressure, which I would be explaining in the next slide. Thank you. Hello students, continuing with our chapter, Absorption by Roots, the processes involved. In the last slide, we had started with little bit understanding of what is osmotic pressure. Okay. Now we had even defined defined what exactly is osmotic pressure. And they had said that it is the minimum pressure that is being exerted to prevent the passage of the pure solvent into the solution when the two are being separated by the semi-permeable membrane. Now, to exactly understand the definition of this osmotic pressure, we have to understand the simple experiment. Okay, now this experiment involves the same setup, wherein we have taken in a beaker. Inside the beaker, we have taken water. Now you have to add the thistle funnel, inverted thistle funnel. Now inside thistle funnel, we have taken concentrated sugar solution. To understand the concept of osmotic pressure, since the term osmosis comes in the word osmotic pressure, we need to see whether osmosis is going to happen or no. And osmotic pressure, okay, something which is going to pressurize osmosis not to happen, right? So we have to add some pressure. Pressure ka matlab samajhte ho? Some kind of weight, some kind of pressure we have to add in this entire setup so that the osmosis should not happen. So something additional to this entire setup is just the adding up of this piston bearing some weight, an airtight piston in this entire pistol funnel bearing some weight. And then the common thing, that is the mouth of the pistol funnel, should be covered with the cellophane membrane. You have to keep the entire setup for an hour or two to see, to observe whether osmosis is going to happen or no. And yes, we notice that there is no osmosis. There is no movement of water from the beaker into the pistol funnel. Now, what does it conclude? It simply concludes that the osmotic pressure, what is an osmotic pressure? It is equivalent to the weight or the pressure which is required. You can even call it as weight. Why weight? Because we have added some weights, right, to the piston. We have added some weights, so it can be measured. It can be said as some weights or pressure which is required to nullify the process of osmosis. Nullify as in to stop, to prevent the process of osmosis. Okay? Now, if you want to define the process of osmotic pressure, you can even say it as it is the measure of its tendency to take in the water by simple osmosis. Okay? What did I say? The measure of its tendency to take in the water by simple osmosis. Or you can even write the simple definition as I had mentioned in the last slide, which I will just read it out. The minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent the passage of the pure solvent into the solution when the two are separated by the semi-permeable membrane. Okay, so these are the two important definitions of osmotic pressure. Right? I hope the concept of osmotic pressure is clear with you all. Now, another concept you all need to understand is about tonicity. Now, what is tonicity? Now, this is related to something about the concentration of the solvent or the solute which is present in the solution. Right? That is what is called as tonicity. Tonicity, if you want to define what is tonicity, it is the concentration of solution which determines, right? I have not written the complete definition. It's written in short. It's the concentration of the solution which determines the direction and the extent of the diffusion of what? Either the solute or the solvent. Okay? What did I say? I would want to repeat it. The concentration of the solution. When I say solution, it includes both. It's a solution is made up of both a solute as well as solvent, right? So the concentration of a solution which determines its extent and direction. Kaun se direction mein diffuse hona hai and kitna diffuse hona hai. Quantity and direction. Kaun se direction mein diffuse hona hai. A to B, for example, if I have two beakers, A and B, okay, or you can say B or C, any beakers, right? So, which direction should the diffusion happen, from A to B or B to C? So, which is going to determine the direction and the extent? Kitna diffuse hona hai? Like if the water has to diffuse, so how many molecules of water has to diffuse? That extent is called as tonicity. Okay? That extent is called as tonicity of that solution. Now, based on the tonicity of the solution, there are three different types of solution. These are called as isotonic solution, hypotonic solution, and hypertonic solution. If you all have not forgotten, I had even mentioned about these three terms in your last slide, not last, I guess second slide, when I was explaining about the concepts of endoosmosis and exoosmosis. Okay, let me just clearly explain you all what do you mean by isotonic solution, hypertonic solution and hypotonic solution. Also, let me make you all understand how is it clearly related with your concepts of osmosis, both endo and exo, right? So, understanding the first tonic solution, that is isotonic solution. Isotonic solution, iso ka matlab hota hai same, tonic ka matlab hota hai concentration, right? So, when I talk about isotonic solution, iska matlab hota hai the concentration of both the solute as well as the solvent, water as well as the solute. Water here I meant by solvent, right? So the concentration of both the solute as well as solvent is same on either side of your membrane, cell membrane. Any semi-permeable membrane or any cell membrane, if you consider, the concentration is found to be the same, right? That kind of solution is called as isotonic solution. So whether osmosis is going to happen or no, we had clearly understood even in our last slide how long is the osmosis going to continue. We even understood that the osmosis is going to stop once the equal distribution of the water molecules has happened, right? So it is obvious jab yahan par same concentration mein water molecules hai, same concentration mein solute molecules hai, to kyun osmosis hoga? So as mentioned, no osmosis is going to take place. Okay, the second type of solution is called as hypotonic solution. Now what do we understand by hypo? Hypo ka matlab hota hai less concentrated. Tonic is again concentration. So hypo stands for less, tonic is concentration. Now here I have drawn a beaker and inside the beaker I have kept a cell. Now what happens to the cell? What is the concentration of the cell? What is the concentration of the solution kept outside the cell? For that you will have to understand this thing, right? So the concentration of the solution outside the cell is, the solute is less and the solvent is more. Okay, and on the same line, if you see the cell inside, placed inside the beaker, the solute is more and the solvent is less. Okay, so what is going to happen? अगर हम ऑस्मोसिस के कंसेप्ट्स को रिलेट करें यहाँ पर, तो व्हाट इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ऑस्मोसिस? मूवमेंट ऑफ द वाटर फ्रॉम हाई वाटर कॉन्सेंट्रेशन टू लो वाटर कॉन्सेंट्रेशन थ्रू अ सेमी परमिएबल मेम्ब्रेन. सो दिस बिहेव्स योर सेमी परमिएबल मेम्ब्रेन. हियर इज योर हाई वाटर कॉन्सेंट्रेशन. सो वाटर इज गोइंग टू मूव फ्रॉम द बीकर इनटू द cell. Okay, the arrow explains it all, and this process is called as endoosmosis, right? What is this process called as? Endoosmosis. The third type is called as hypertonic solution. Now as you can see clearly in the diagram, what is hypertonic solution? Now in the hypertonic solution, you can see the solution outside the beaker is having high solute concentration and low solvent concentration. And what is the state of the cell kept inside the beaker? The cell is having low solute concentration and high solvent concentration. Okay, now how is the osmosis going to happen? Okay, can you all think about it? It is obvious that now, since the solvent is high inside the cell, the water is going to move from the cell outside into the beaker. The arrow is clearly indicating in, and this process where the water is moving out from the cell is called as exoosmosis, and therefore mentioned that exoosmosis is going to take place or occur when the cell is kept in a hypertonic solution. Okay, so the solution here is hypertonic. So hyper means what? Where the solute concentration is high and the solvent concentration is low. What is going to happen? Exoosmosis is going to happen. Okay, now these are the simplified diagrams which I have shown you. Okay, but your textbook has shown a more modified version of the diagram. I would just want you all to open your textbooks also when you all are going through the slides and just see through the diagrams. Now, what are these diagrams of? Now, these are the diagrams both of the animal cell as well as of the plant cell. Okay, now here to explain you all the concepts of all these three solutions and the concepts of endo and exoosmosis, the examples of RBC cell as an animal cell and the plant cell is taken into consideration, and it's being seen how the shape and the structure of the cell changes. How the shape and the structure of the cell changes when the cell undergoes the process of exo and endoosmosis. Okay, so starting with the first type of solution, if you try to keep the cell, maybe the animal cell, that is RBC, or the plant cell, any plant cell is no option, any plant cell, like you take a root cell or a stem cell, a leaf cell, any part of the plant cell, and if you keep it in a isotonic solution. Now, isotonic solution, you all know what is isotonic solution by now, right? So if you keep that cell in the isotonic solution, you all would see no change in the shape and the size of the cell. Okay, so the shape and the size remains unchanged. When you keep the cell, either of the cells, in the hypertonic solution, what happens is, when the solution is hypertonic, this one, what's going to happen is, the water from the cell is going to move out into the solution. Thereby, it is obvious when the water is inside the cell and the water is going to move out, you can imagine what can happen. The cell is going to lose its original shape. Okay, just think of this diagram. Just look at this diagram. This is the diagram of the RBC and this is the diagram of the plant cell. So when kept in the hypertonic solution, what's going to happen? Is going to lose its shape and the cell is going to shrink. So if the original shape was this, the shrunken shape of the cell is this. It is obvious, no? Look at this cell, it is turgid. Look at this cell, it is flaccid. Okay? Now, again, what would happen if you keep the cell in the hypotonic solution? That is this example. What's going to happen? Here, the water is going to enter inside the cell. Now, when the water is going to enter inside the cell, there can be the condition where so much of water can enter that the cell might even burst. So, if this is the original shape of the cell, if the excess of water can enter, would enter, it might even result in the bursting of the cell. Now, there is one additional property which is seen in the plant cell but which is not being observed in the animal cell. Why? Because plant cell has one more protective layer, one more protective covering, that is called as cell wall. Okay, that maintains the rigidity of the plant cell. right? So in plant cell, there is another important feature that has been defined when we learn about the concepts of the endo and exoosmosis. And that concept is about the rigidity of the cell wall. Okay, so what happens is the plant cell never bursts. Okay, neither the plant cell never becomes completely flaccid. Okay, why? Because of the cell wall present. Okay, so this cell wall maintains the rigidity of the plant cell, thereby it also protects the inner content of the plant cell. Now these concepts could be even helpful to us while learning about the further last phenomenon of the absorption processes, that is the flaccidity, turgidity, that we'll be doing in the when we are going to learn about the processes, right? The fourth important, here we give a complete end to the third phenomenon called as osmosis and osmotic pressure. I hope all your concepts related to osmosis, osmotic pressure, the experiments, the tonicity, the different types of solutions are very clear with you all, right? Now, starting with the fourth different type of phenomenon, that is active transport. Okay, now what is this active transport? Now, the passage of the substances. This substance can be either a salt or sugar or even ions, but the movement or the passing of this substance happens from the higher concentration, from the lower concentration to the higher concentration. Till now, we have always understood that the ions move from the high concentration to the low concentration. Okay, and when that was the scenario, we saw that it was normal and natural movement. We saw that thing in osmosis, which includes the movement of the water molecules. We saw that thing in diffusion, which includes the movements of the ions and also the other substances. But my dear students, try to understand, active transport includes the movement of the substances from the low concentration to the high concentration. When things move from the low concentration to high concentration, it requires lot of energy, and that energy is being given to that cell from the cell itself. Like for example, if I want to lift certain thing, then who would give me that energy? Me, myself. Okay, I would be getting the energy from within me. Okay, from the food I eat. Okay, so what would be active transport? It is the passage of the substances from low concentration to high concentration through the living membrane using the energy from the cell itself. Now, how exactly this process happens? Now, if you consider the example of the root cells, the root cells have certain ions, like for example manganese, nitrates, sulfates, potassium, all these things in very high concentration. These all ionic forms of the minerals are present in the root cells in very high concentration. Can you all just think of why are they in high concentration? The answer is right besides the question mark. The answer is in order to maintain the osmotic pressure. OP stands for osmotic pressure, so that the roots can absorb the water from the soil. Try to understand, roots are not only responsible for taking up the water from the soil, but their responsibility is also to absorb the minerals. But to absorb the water from the soil, they have to maintain the high मिनरल कंटेंट इन देयर रूट्स. जब मिनरल्स उनके रूट्स में हाई होंगे तभी तो सॉल्ट कम होगा ना, सॉरी तभी तो वाटर कम होगा, राइट. व्हेन द वाटर बिकम्स लेस ओनली देन दे कैन एब्जॉर्ब द वाटर फ्रॉम द सॉइल थ्रू ऑस्मोसिस. सो These minerals are in high concentration in the root cell. Why? So that they can maintain that osmotic pressure and they can absorb the water from the soil. Therefore, it is seen that inside the roots, these all nutrients are in the high concentration. Since they are in high concentration, they will have to forcefully pull these all nutrients from the soil. Any which ways they will have to pull these nutrients from the soil. But that pulling would be forceful pulling of these nutrients from the soil. And that too, those nutrients would be in lower concentration in the soil as compared to that present in the roots. And since the nutrients present in the soil would be in lower concentration, the roots would be requiring lot of energy to pull them. And that energy is in the form of ATP. And such movement, such passing of the ions, substances from the low concentration to the high concentration with the involvement of the energy in the form of ATP is called as active transport. You must have even come across the word passive transport. Okay, now what is passive transport basically? Now passive transport is nothing but it is equal to the process of diffusion, right? Diffusion mein we have already learned that it is the movement from the high concentration to the low concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. Okay, but active transport would be what? It would be opposite to the process of diffusion. That is movement from low to high with the involvement of energy. Okay. Whereas passive is without the involvement of energy. Okay, I hope both the differences between active and passive transport along with the definition of the active transport is pretty clear with you. That's all for this slide. Thank you.